Hey guys, this morning, Hebrews chapter 4 is where we find ourselves on our way through the great adventure, reading through the Bible together. I hope most of you got a chance to read Hebrews chapter 7 this morning. You'll probably, your mind will probably go to some of those things that you discovered this morning as you read that. And as you're turning there, my wife and I would like to say thank you for all of you who are praying for us. We see it in the physical realm. We sense it in the spiritual realm, the emotional realm. Thank you so much for praying, and don't stop. Okay, just don't stop praying. So God is good. So let's pray, and then let's jump in together. Father in heaven, thank you for your word. We ask that you would speak through your word to your people. Holy Spirit, come and touch every heart. Not one message, every message for every soul that's here this morning. In Jesus' name. Amen. Hebrews chapter 4, starting in verse 11, says, "Let us therefore be diligent to enter that rest, lest anyone fall according to the same example of disobedience. For the word of God is living and powerful, and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit and joints and marrow, and is the discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. And there is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give account." And because we must give account to the one who sees all, it says now, "Seeing that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. And let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need." Now, this passage starts with a warning. It starts with an instruction and a warning. First of all, it says, "Let us therefore be diligent to enter that rest, lest anyone fall according to the same example of disobedience." There was the bodies of an entire generation of the Jewish people fell in the wilderness because of their disobedience, because of their lack of faith, because they didn't trust God, they didn't believe God. They literally fell and died in a wilderness experience that they didn't need to experience if they would have trusted God. What we have to understand is that we have to be careful that we also enter in. There's an issue of diligence. He says, "Let us therefore be diligent." In other words, let's be purposeful. Let's work at it. Let's put some action into it. Let's put some heart and soul into making sure that we enter the rest. Now, isn't it interesting that we work to enter the rest? But we don't want to miss out on what the rest is. I'm just going to cut to the chase this morning. The rest for us is Jesus Christ. We find our rest in Jesus Christ. We find our hope in Jesus Christ. We find our joy in Jesus Christ. Let's be diligent to enter in to Jesus Christ and be careful that we do not begin to drift away, because it is easy for us to drift away from the things that are important in our lives. There are things that distract us, and so we need to make sure as believers that we are leaning in to the rest that is found in Jesus Christ. Somebody asked me one time, they go, "Well, you don't celebrate the Sabbath." I said, "I'm in a Sabbath. I'm in Jesus. I rest every day." But if you want to argue about this, church, let me help you with something. The Sabbath is from Friday night to Saturday night. It'll always be that way. Just so you guys know, that's where the Sabbath is. That's where it's always going to be. We meet on the first day of the week. Do you know why we meet on the first day of the week? Because Jesus rose on the first day of the week. It's a Sunday. So if anybody ever asks you, why does your church meet on Sunday? Because Jesus rose on Sunday, and we start the week remembering the resurrection. So make sure that you know that. Don't get confused by it. If people talk to you about it, just know this. You know when the Sabbath is. But remember this. There is a Sabbath rest every day when we are in Christ Jesus. We rest in Christ every day, and we find that in him. And so he goes on now, and he says, "For the word of God is living and powerful." I'm going to give you some things to write down in your notes this morning, and I'd like to share them with you in the first tense, in a personal tense, because I want you to understand that this applies to us personally, to you and I. Number one is this: God knows the real me. I want to write that down this morning. You want to realize that God knows the real me. So when I think about my life, God knows the real me. I can say God knows the real you, because God really knows who we are. It says, "For the word of God is living and powerful, sharper than a two-edged sword." The Bible is not a collection of old dusty stories, of crazy mythology. The Bible is alive with life, and it is alive with power. Don't ever misunderstand this. A preacher does not make the Bible alive. The Bible makes the preacher alive. Amen. And for any person who will understand and read the Word of God, it is living and it is powerful and will bring them into a place of life as their faith is grown and increases. For faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God, as Romans 10:17 tells us. But not only is it alive, but it's also powerful. In the King James, it's translated active, which is a good translation. The idea is that God's Word is both living and powerful in the sense that it is active. But let me just share something with you just for fun. I want to share something with you about the Word. 1 John chapter 1, verse 1 explains to us that the Word is God. In verse 14 of chapter 1 of the first chapter of John, it says this, that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Does that sound familiar to anybody? Who was God that came and dwelt among us? It was Jesus, that's right. In Revelation chapter 19, when Jesus returns, there is a name on him. Do you guys remember what the name is on Jesus? The Word of God. When you read the Word is living and powerful. The Word is God. It is God's Word. And it is Jesus that we understand. Jesus, the Word of God. The Word of God is powerful and living. Jesus is alive. Jesus is powerful. Jesus is active. Jesus is moving. And Jesus knows the real you. Church, Jesus knows the real you. Now the idea goes on and says, and it is sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit, to the joints and marrow, and is the thought and is the discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Please understand this idea of it's sharp. It's a sharp two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and spirit. We could talk for hours on that issue. But it goes on and talks about the joint and the marrow, the spiritual issues in our life, the physical issues in our life, and is the thought and discerner of the intents of the heart, the emotional issues, the thought issues in our life. God looks down and he sees it all. God knows it all. The Word of God is the discerner. When you read the Word of God, it comes in and it starts to pierce through and separate and show us right from wrong, light from dark in our lives. The Word of God reaches us with surprising accuracy. Have you ever noticed that? Have you ever been in a place in your life that you know you need to read the Word of God, but you don't want to read the Word of God because you know the Word of God's going to tell you what you don't want to hear? You know that morning you get up, you have your cup of coffee saying, Lord, I want to have devotion with you, but you're going to correct me this morning, so I'm going to watch the news instead. We all have those moments. We know because God's Word comes in and deals with us. The Holy Spirit searches the heart of men and the spirit of men. And God's Word is truth, and God knows that truth. And the Holy Spirit empowers the Word of God to become this vessel that comes and works deeply in our lives. See, in our lives, we have a tendency to lie a lot. I don't know if you know this, but we have a tendency to not tell the truth. In fact, I'm sure, how many of you have lied this morning? Show of hands. When I'm done, you will all raise your hand. Now listen. Here's the thing. We do this to each other all the time. See, it's a social issue for us. Somebody asks us how we're doing, and we go, I'm well. Or they come in, you come into church, they go, how are you? I'm blessed. I'm just Jesus on the throne. I'm blessed. It's awesome, you know. And the Lord's good to me. And you know what? Your reality is you got a flat tire. You fought with your wife and her husband all the way here. Your kids didn't get up on time. And you woke up to a cat on you going, ah, ah. You know, does that only happen to me? So you understand that, that's what happened. You know, you realize that's what's happening in your life. And all of a sudden you go, what? You know, and you're not being honest. See, listen, we lie all the time. And see, God sees the stuff inside. God knows the real us. God knows the real problem. He knows what's happening in there. So please, don't for one moment think that you're getting away with it. So here's what would be really good for the church. See, what if we were really honest with each other? What if we entered into what's real, known as real koinonia? Somebody says, hey, how you doing? And you said, well, I'm going to share with you how I'm doing. And then we prayed for each other every time that happened. Could you imagine how long it would take for us to start a service? Why? Because you all be out in the foyer in a parking lot. You'd see somebody getting out of their car. Hey, how you doing? Oh, man, it's a rough morning. Oh, man, let me pray for you. That's what koinonia, by the way. If you've ever wondered what koinonia is, that's what koinonia is. Koinonia is real fellowship. It's when you ask somebody how they're doing, and you go, how you doing? They go, fine. Then you go, how are you doing? And they go, oh, you really want to know. So I want to encourage you, church, if you ask somebody how they're doing, be ready for them to tell you the truth. When they tell you the truth, you be ready to pour out grace and mercy, and you pray for them. Don't hold that back. Make sure that we do that. But the idea is, man, God knows. God sees the stuff. We try and hide it. We try and lie about it. But you know what? We can lie to everybody else, but we can't lie to God because God knows the truth in an instant. Here's the second thing. If you're taking notes, number two is this, is I cannot hide from God. God knows the real me. He knows what's going on spiritually with me. He knows what's going on physically with me. He knows what's going on intellectually with me. God knows all those things. But the issue is I cannot hide from God. It says in verse 13, and there is no creature hidden from his sight. But all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. Naked. Everything is naked. Think about Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve were naked and they were unashamed, and then sin came in, and then they were ashamed before God. Remember what happened? You know, God shows up. Hey, where are you guys at? They're hiding themselves. Why? Because they were naked. God said, who told you you were naked? Oh, we ate of the tree. You told us not to eat. They were ashamed because they did something that God told them not to do. How many of you guys can understand the idea of being totally exposed before God because you did something you didn't want to, you weren't supposed to do, right? See, that's the truth. Many of us don't want to come to God in that idea of openness and nakedness because we are ashamed. We are ashamed of what we did. But listen, the idea of naked and open, the word for open is like a Greek wrestler who would wrestle his opponent to the point where they're totally laid out as defeated. Now think about that for a moment. You might be trying to hide from God, but God's going to come in because he knows you and he's going to defeat you and you're trying to hide from him and you're still going to be laid open. So wouldn't it be easier just to come and say, God, here I am? How many times do I do that with my kids? Did you do that? No. Then the next thing is, well, okay, well, I may have been involved in that, right? Because, see, God knows. My son asked me one time, he goes, does God tell you everything stupid that I do? I said, son, let me in a little secret. I've done all your stupid better than you. So that's why I know. It's not like some really awesome trick. I've done what you've done. But the issue is everything's naked. Everything's open to the one who must give account. See, we can fight it. We can fight it. We can argue with God. We can bargain with God. But in the end, God's going to have the victory. God is going to have the victory in our life. And here's why. Because ultimately, here's number three. If you're taking notes, you're following along. Number three is because God does hold me accountable. God does hold me accountable. I want to share with you, God holds me accountable. What does that mean? That means that in everything that I do, in my thought life and in my action life, God holds me accountable. I know the thought life one is hard, but you have to understand that God is going to hold you accountable to the stuff going on inside as much as the stuff outside. Because God knows who we really are anyway. God knows the truth of who we are. God knows the truth. We can't hide from that, and we're accountable to him. He's going to hold us accountable for that, but because God is going to hold us accountable because of his justice, because of his holiness, he's done something for us. Listen, what did he do? He sent Jesus Christ, church. He sent Jesus. Jesus died for all of our mistakes, all of our failures, all of our sin. He who knew no sin became sin for us, and he became the great high priest. Listen, verse 14, seeing then that we have a great high priest, a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession. I'm going to go back and talk about Jesus and the great high priest, but holding fast our confession, what does that mean? Well, if we're supposed to be diligent to enter into the rest, we're supposed to hold fast our confession. These are action issues. We want to have action and take action to be in a place where we're secure in our faith. When we call upon Jesus, we call upon the Lord, we want to hold fast to that calling. We don't want to be wandering around saying, oh, maybe I did, maybe I didn't. We want to hold on to the Lord. We want to hold that confession. I am a Christian and I'm going to follow Christ no matter what it takes. That's holding fast. Unmovable. But seeing that we have a great high priest, no other priest was called great. Church, listen, no other priest was called great. No other high priest was called great. No other high priest passed through the heavens. No other high priest is the Son of God. And who is the Son of God that passed through the heavens and is now seated at the right hand of God? Who is it, church? It's Jesus. That's right. And we have a compassionate high priest, and his name is Jesus. See, please understand as we go to number four this morning is this. So number four is this. God understands my weakness. God understands my weakness. He's not in heaven looking down going, why'd you do that? God looks down and he understands. He understands that I'm weak. He understands the weakness of human flesh. He understands the temptation of sin. He understands. It says in verse 15, for we do not have a high priest, speaking of our Jesus, the Son of God, who came, died, rose again from the dead, and ascended into heaven, and now sits as the advocate for us, for you and I, Jesus in heaven right now. He says, for we do not have a high priest, Jesus, who cannot sympathize with our weakness. He can have sympathy on us in our weakness, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Jesus was tempted in every way that we're tempted, yet without sin, but a lot of people misunderstand that. And I want to clarify what that means this morning, that Jesus was tempted as all points as we are, yet without sin. See, Jesus did not have the issues of being tempted by the trappings of the internet, okay? There's still places in Idaho that don't have the internet, so they didn't have it back then either, okay? So you understand. So, you know, like, we can't get it in this room, okay? So understand, he didn't have a problem there, you know? He didn't have that problem. Jesus was not tempted to binge watch The Walking Dead on Netflix over the weekend. He wasn't tempted by that. He wasn't distracted at a family meal by a cell phone. He wasn't, all those things, he wasn't tempted by those things. But it says that Jesus was tempted in all points as we are, yet without sin. So we have to understand how we're tempted so we can understand how he was tempted so we can know as believers that he was tempted in all points as we are, yet without sin, so we can have confidence when we come to him. So please turn with me to 1 John chapter 2, verse 16, or write it in your notes. You can look it up later. They'll also put it up on the screen. But Jesus was tempted in all points as we are. Let's go ahead and look at this verse. 1 John chapter 2, verse 16 says this, for all that is in the world, that's an encompassing statement, all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. There are three areas here where we are tempted, and in the same way Jesus was tempted. The number one thing, if you're taking notes, you've been following along, and this particular idea is this. How was Jesus tempted? How are we tempted? Number one, it's the lust of the flesh. Number one, the lust of the flesh. What is that? That's pleasure. He was tempted in the lust of the flesh, so tempted for pleasure. Things that we see, things that we would do for pleasure. The second thing is the lust of the eyes, possessions, the covetousness to have other possessions that aren't yours. The idea of being tempted with possession. And then the third is the pride of life, position. These ideas that you understand that Jesus was tempted in all these points just as we are. And by the way, in our modern world, there's a lot more things that tempt us. The simpler lifestyle, I mean, when there was no power, when you had to chop wood year-round just to survive, you weren't tempted with laziness or you would die. Think about that for a minute. You know, there are places in Idaho, I don't know if you guys know this, there are still people living off the grid. They're living off the land and off the grid. No power, no refrigeration. Animals, gardens, hunting. When there's light out, there's light. When the sun goes down, there's no light. They're still living off the grid. Simpler lives. They're not distracted by a lot of stuff we're distracted with. Yet even in that simple lifestyle, there's still the lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. And Jesus was tempted in all those ways. And if you're not sure Jesus was tempted in all those ways, here's some homework for you. And I know as we're going through the Bible, we're reading lots of chapters every day, but listen. Matthew chapter 4, you will see Jesus tempted with the lust of the eyes, lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. And I know I just said that out of order. By the way, I was just checking to see if you were paying attention. So the lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. He was tempted as all points as we are, yet without sin. Thank God. And we should praise God that it was without sin, because then he could be the faithful high priest who could die in our place. So what happens is after we understand that, you know, he understands our weaknesses, he's tempted as all points as we are, comes to number five, which is that he calls me to come in my weakness. So Jesus calls me to come in my weakness. So in being exposed in my weakness, he calls me to come to him. Now, I just want to share with you, I had three different points, though I was just going to do real three points, but I thought they were a little foolish, so I didn't use them. But if you want to remember this another way, it's God knows you're stupid, God understands you're stupid, and God says, come with your stupid. Some of you might appreciate that. That I thought would be the bumper sticker or the tweet, the Twitter post later. But I mean, that's the issue right there. God knows our stupid. He's familiar with our stupid. He says, "Come with your stupid. Come with your mistakes." So God understands. But I thought, God calls me to come in my weakness. Sounded more mature. But verse 16 says this: because of these things, because we have a great high priest, because God knows what's going on, because he sees us, we can't hide from it, we're accountable to him, he sent Jesus, we have a high priest, he understands us, he says, "What? Therefore, let us come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain favor and find grace to help in time of need." Let us come boldly and get help. So let us come boldly. The idea is that because we have an all-knowing God, he knows our stuff, he understands, an all-knowing, an understanding high priest, we come boldly to his throne. But when we come to his throne, church, it's to a throne of grace. It's to a throne of mercy. See, the devil has some strategies. And some of you may be familiar with these strategies. I'm going to share two of them with you this morning about this issue. God says, his word says, come boldly. Come to me. And so what the devil does, the devil says, no, Jesus is unapproachable by you. See, you've messed up so bad, you can't come to Jesus. The devil makes you think you have to work yourself into a place of acceptance before you can come be accepted. And that is a lie from the pit of hell. You do not have to do anything right now. All you have to do is come to Jesus because Jesus has made the way. You don't have to get right. You come to Jesus, he will make it right. You don't have to get cleaned up. You come to Jesus in your filth, and he will give you cleansing. That's who Jesus is. Please understand, don't get caught in this place of thinking that you have to get the bath before you get the shower. Look, I'll be honest, I've hosed my boys off before they came in the house. But when it comes to the things of God, we can come boldly and just say, Jesus, I'm here with all my mess, naked and open. And let me share something with you about this concept, church, if you could get your hands on this. When you come boldly, you come naked and unashamed. You bring it all to Jesus. You don't hide anything. You don't keep that closet. Well, God doesn't need to know about that, He already knows. Just bring it all. When I come to the Lord, it's more like I got a dually with a Trump truck. I was like, Lord, I got some stuff here. He goes, yeah, I know, I've been waiting. Because I died for all that stuff. Can I take that from you, Ty? And Jesus takes it from me. So I don't have to carry it anymore. Here's the second thing the devil wants to do. The devil wants to make Jesus seem like he cannot help. Guess what? The word of God is living and powerful. Jesus is alive and he's powerful and he's holy and he's righteous and he's sitting on the throne of God and he can help. He can help you today. He can help me today. But the devil wants to make you think that he's just a man. He's just a good teacher. And you know what? You're going to find another way to get help. You're going to find another way to get to heaven because Jesus can't do it. I am sorry. The scripture says, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's it. End of story. Bible says it. I believe it. That settles it. If you need help, if you need to come to Jesus, you can come to Jesus today and Jesus can help you. Do not think that he is a glorified man. He is not a glorified man. Jesus is the Son of God. And the Son of God came and took all of our sin and died in our place that we can come boldly to him. And you can come boldly this morning. If you do not have a relationship with Jesus, you can come boldly today and be forgiven for not one of your sins, not 10 of your sins, not a few of your sins, all of your sins. Everything that you've ever done, you can come and bring to him openly this morning. So the idea of coming boldly, I'm going to share with you what that means. First thing I'm going to do is I'm going to tell you what it does not mean. Coming boldly does not mean coming proudly, arrogantly, or with presumption. In other words, you don't show up going, peace out, what up, God? I got some things I need you to take care of. Good. Hook me up. All right. That's not how that goes, okay? He calls me friend, he calls me brother, but that's not how that goes. I come differently than that. Let me explain how I come. I come in humility, but I come not with pride, not with arrogance, not with presumption. I come to him in five ways. You can write them down this morning if you'd like. Number one is this: I come consistently. To come boldly to God is to come consistently. I'm not going to come to him once or twice. I'm going to come consistently. not going to stop. I'm going to continue to love and pour out my heart before him and tell him what I need, tell him what I desire, tell him my hurts, tell him the things I'm screwing up in my life. And I'm just going to come to him all the time. I come boldly, so I come consistently. Number two is I come without reservation. I come to God and I come without reservation. I come without fear that he's going to look down on me or he's going to be awful to me. I just come without reservation because I can come. He says, come boldly to the throne of grace. So I'm going to come boldly. I'm going to come consistently, and I'm going to come and say, I'm going to come without reservation before the Lord. I believe that our God can. Do you guys believe that your God can?
Yeah.
How many of you believe God can? I do. I believe God can. Amen. So listen, in my life, I have never, ever asked for anything small. I believe the word of God when it says God can do exceedingly abundantly above all that I could ask or think. And I look at God sometimes in prayer and I go, this is a big one. I'm going to ask this. It's okay if he tells me no, but I'm going to ask anyway because I'm going to come consistently and I'm going to come with that sense of confidence without reservation. And I'll come back and talk about that idea of asking for big from the Lord in a moment. But here's the next thing is I come freely. So this is the third thing. I come freely without fancy words. Now, I don't know if any of you have ever gotten to that place where you try and make your prayers fancy. Let me share something with you about prayer. Prayer is simple communication with a God who can help. When I moved to Salmon, they did something there that I wasn't used to. They burned everything. They burned their ditches, burned their fields, burned their trash. I wasn't used to that. So I was out burning a ditch. And I thought I was really confident. It was later in the evening. It was a cool evening, so I didn't think it would be a problem. Not realizing you never, ever burn in the evening because the moment you light a fire, that's when the wind's going to blow. And it never blows in Salmon. The wind blows here all the time. It never blows in Salmon unless I'm burning a ditch. Now, here's the thing. So I have this little ditch, and I'm burning this ditch. It's a culvert, and I'm burning this ditch. I'm getting all these weeds out of it, and I'm burning this. And it's fall. All the hoses are put away. We've already had a couple of hard frosts. And I've got a little pump sprayer out there, and I'm, you know, spraying it with a pump sprayer because I think I'm hot stuff. You know, it's cool. It's in the evening. And I'm praying it. And then there was a wind that came up and came through the culvert where I was burning and turned it into a little whirlwind. And then the gates of hell lit right in front of me. And I was like, Lord, deliver me. So let me explain the prayer. This is the only prayer that I could pray at that time. I'm pumping this pump sprayer, and I'm going, Jesus, put out this fire. Jesus, put out this fire. Jesus, put out the fire. Put out this fire. And that's all I had. I'm pumping for everything I'm worth on a thing that's almost empty. I think the Lord may have given me more water. And I don't know if there was a miracle, but I'm pumping. And, you know, that fire went out. My sons come running out. They start grabbing hoses that are all frozen. You can hear the ice breaking as they're trying to help. I didn't call for them. My sons came because I was calling out to Jesus. The house was like a half acre away. And I'm just crying out to Jesus. Do you understand that's what it is to come without fancy words? And you come freely. Lord, I have a need. Help me with my need. That's it. You know that time when you're on the freeway and your car starts to give and the only two words you can get out, Jesus help! That's all you got. That's coming boldly. There's no arrogance in that. There's no pride in that. That's just coming boldly. So we come with confidence. That's the fourth thing. We come with confidence. So what does it mean to come with confidence? So we come to God with confidence. That's the idea of we believe that God can ask for bigger things. Well, I've been praying. I said, Lord, would you just provide to pay off, just pay off all the debt? And give us everything we need to finish the property and fulfill the vision that you have begun here. Would you do that? God, would you do that? And I have no problem asking God for that. Because my God can do bigger than that. And that blows my mind. I can ask for big from my big God because I believe God is big. I've never done anything thinking that my God was small. I've done things in smaller communities that churches in bigger communities do. And they go, why do you do that? You're a small church in a small town. Why would you do that? I'm like, because I serve a big God. What's your problem? What, you think population diminishes the size of God? Oh, no, no, no. Our God is a great, big God. And we come to him without arrogance. We come to him with no pride. We come without presumption. We come consistently. We come with we come without reservation, freely, without fancy words. And we do it with some confidence. And the fifth thing is this, is boldness means that we should come with some persistence. We come with persistence. Did you guys know that the word no really never stops my boys from asking again? My boys will say, hey, can we get pizza? No. Can we get pizza? No. Can we get ice cream? No. Can I get a car? No. Can I get my license? No. Can I get it now? No. Can I get it tomorrow? No. Later that night, ding. No, you can't get your license. And, you know, so it's like, it's this constant thing. But I want you to think about it. Father, you know, a father-son relationship. Just because I tell them no doesn't mean they stop asking. If you've ever gotten a no from God, don't stop asking. You keep asking. You keep coming boldly to the throne of grace and find mercy and get help in time of need. You don't stop. Just because you hear no, that's okay. Can I tell you a little secret about a no from God? That's an answer. And that means God's speaking to you in prayer. I had somebody tell me one time, I'm praying all the time and God never speaks to me. I said, well, what's happening? See, I keep getting no. I said, that's an answer, dude. It's not the answer you want. So I used the word dude. It was back in the 90s. But but I said, you know, dude, okay. But the idea is like you got your answer, man. God is speaking to you. But we come boldly where? We come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. When we come, we obtain mercy. That's not getting what we do deserve. See, God, in his justice, should judge our sin. But because of his mercy, he doesn't give us that judgment. He says simply, come, because I understand you. I know you. I know what's happening with you. Come to me, because I have something for you. I have a throne of grace. And I want you to come to that throne of grace, and that's getting what you don't deserve. And then the idea is, you know, we get that what we don't deserve. And in our time of need, we get help from God. Remember, God's grace does not ignore his justice. It's just the issue of the fulfillment of God's grace on the cross, what Jesus did on the cross, that allows us to come boldly to Jesus. And I'm going to have the worship team come out. We're going to close in a song, but as we close up, I want you to consider this. We need to be thankful that God provides help in time of need. If you're here this morning and you have a need in your life, God is here to help. God is here to help you in your time of need. Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 says this. The idea is that God says that we are to be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let our requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guard our heart and mind in Christ Jesus. Church, I want you to realize something. There is no request too small for God. And there is no request too big for God. If you need help in your marriage, God is here to help. If you need help in your family, God is here to help. If you need help with your kids, and I understand that one, God is here to help. But maybe you don't even know you have a need. Maybe your need this morning is salvation. Maybe your need is the fact that you need to have your sins forgiven by a gracious and holy God. If you're here this morning and you do not have a relationship with Jesus, I don't want you to leave here without. Now, you might not realize what your need is. Let me explain what that need is so you understand. That need that you have in your life right now is the need to be forgiven of sin. Sin is if you've ever told a lie, if you've ever stolen anything, if you've ever lusted after somebody, if you've ever hated somebody in your heart. Those are all sins that would get you eternal destruction if you stood before God today in death and had to be judged for your life. But Jesus Christ came and he died for all of your sins. He who knew no sin became sin for you, that in his resurrection, you can come to him boldly and find grace and mercy and be set free from sin. And I want to encourage you, there are going to be guys up here after service, and I want to encourage you to be bold. If you need help today, if you need prayer today, if you need Jesus, if you want salvation today, to just call upon the name of the Lord. That's what the scripture says. Call upon the name of the Lord and you shall be saved. Who's the name of the Lord? We've already said it. Our great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. That's who we call upon for salvation. And so maybe today you would have boldness and you would stand up and say, hey, I've received the Lord. I want to call upon the Lord. And they're going to pray for you and they're going to encourage you. Let's pray, church. Father in heaven, thank you for this morning. I thank you for your good, good love and that you love us. Lord, I pray that this morning your church would no longer ever hesitate in prayer. But Lord, we'd come boldly in everything. God, we'd say, Lord, I need you. I want you. You're here for me. And we just bring it all. We bring everything to you, Lord, no matter how big, no matter how small. We would come with humility, but God, we'd come in boldness, knowing that you can. Because you can, we give it all over to you. Lord, save the lost souls. Draw them to yourself by your power, not by my preaching, but by your word that is alive. Draw them to yourself that they might be saved and experience a new life that is found only in Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name, God's kids say, amen.